Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to welcome all of the resource persons, faculty members, and participants in our 2 days international webinar on health issues and social status of women, organized by Department of Anthropology of Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya and Department of Anthropology of Ramshadai College, Amta, in association with Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya and also the Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Ramshadai College, Amta. Yesterday, our eminent speakers have been enlightened our knowledge on some specific health issues like polycystic ovarian syndrome and anthropometric understanding and development of breast cancer and its impact on women's daily lifestyle throughout the globe. This is the last day of our 2 days webinar. As per theme, today we are going to discuss about social status of Indian women. The best thermometer to the progress of a nation is its treatment of its women. The social status of women in a society basically represents the standardization of a culture or the social acceptance of a girl. Indian historic background has been revealed the dynamic social position of women. In India, the Vedic time period was a golden era for women's life. After this, the social status of women started to decline. In medieval phase, women have obtained the equal rights only in front of God. The concept of the Devadasi was suddenly appeared with a colorful religious packaging as well as the practice of child marriage. Sati Pratha are good enough to understand the position of women in medieval past. After a decade, British ruled government was strictly against of Sati Pratha, child marriage and polygamy as well. In respect of the earlier phase, the social position of women were slightly improved. To describe the femininity, several terms has been used like female, girl, lady, woman, etc. Every feminine selves have their own untold stories in their every phases of life. Women are worshipped as deity. On the other hand, they are victimized by means of several subjects. This is the two sides of a coin. Needless to say, patriarchy is deeply embedded in our soul, irrespective of gender and age. Different feminist movements are failed to abolish the gender inequality. Samonde Babur symbolized women as a second sex, the struggle of womanhood as long as the world exists. This struggle encompasses their educational and social rights, rights for equality. Moreover, for their nation too. As a freedom fighter, they are less appreciated in comparison to men. It may ironically represent that women are most valuable to maintain the motion of the globe, whereas the women's physique occupy a different price tag as culture varies. As a woman, it's next to impossible to frame the status of women, since some narratives has been disappeared in course of time. The endless struggle of women, orthodox gender stereotyping, and tradition-bound cultural beliefs and practices are unitedly formed an incredible lens to rethink the status of women in our present-day situation. Numerous social relations are capable to create an invisible enclosure in the surroundings of women, which is really hard to unbind these ties. Several attempts have been taken to portray a perfect form of life. Some major issues are related to women and womanhood, that is, the marriage, adoption, guardianship, and abortion of a child. Again, I would like to maintain a quote of Swami Vivekananda. The highest of all feminine types in India is mother, higher than wife. Wife and children may a desert of man, but his mother never. Mother is the same or love her child perhaps a little more. Mother represents colorless love that knows no butter, love that never dies. Who can have such love? Only mother, not son, not daughter, nor wife. I am the power that manifests everything, says the mother. She who bringing out this universe and she who is bringing forth the following destruction. No need to say that Destruction is the only beginning of creation. The top of a hill is the only beginning of a valley. So, 1,000 times of this discussion will remain inadequate to disclose the actual status of women. Today, I want to restart our journey to holding the hands of our eminent speaker towards that valley. Now, I would like to request Mr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee to deliver their inaugural speech to accelerate our session.
Good evening, everybody. Heartiest greetings and a warm welcome to all those who are present live on this international webinar program being organized by the Department of Anthropology in collaboration with the IQSECL of two neighboring colleges in the district of Howrah. Today is the second day of the two-day international webinar, and I'm proud to be associated with the galaxy of stars present on both days to share their view and their opinion with the students and the participants. Anthropology as a modern subject is no longer limited to the scientific study of humanity or human evolution from the Paleolithic hunter-gatherer community life to the present age human beings, but has evolved over years as a multidisciplinary subject encompassing various aspects of human life, like health, diseases, healthcare system, adaptation, and so on, and has conglomerated with different fields of education. The subject is so diverse in its own way that it has several sub-branches, I would rather say, like cultural, social anthropology, linguistics, anthropology, then the physiology, genetics, ethnomusical, and even several aspects of environment has been covered, as we have seen in the lecture of several speakers yesterday. Now, the focus on feminism from an anthropological lens to view the role of women in the society, their contribution in the social sciences, has given a new dimension to the subject, which has come up as feminist anthropology. The transformation in this subject is so wide that even its effect we can find in our rural college as well. A few years back, maybe 5 or 6 years back, not all students were interested in the subject, and almost 50 to 60% of the seats remained vacant. And the students were rather confused about the future of this course. But in recent years, we have seen a transformation in the mind of the students, and we have witnessed almost 80 to 85% of the seats rather filled up after 3 or 4 e-counseling processes. And this year, we are going to have a full house since a very few vacant seats are there. And I'm hopeful that these seats will be filled up after the de-reservation process from the waiting list of candidates. All the credit, however, should go to the faculty members for their untiring effort to bring good to the students, to get their confidence, and to show them the importance of the subject in recent years. But I personally feel that the fieldwork involved in the subject, the fun of learning associated with it, the scientific temper created in the minds of the students by the researchers, by the discoveries made in recent years, responsible for the transition or the transformation that we have witnessed in recent years. Yesterday, we have heard a lot from the speakers about obesity, about breast cancer, and many more things are yet to come in today's webinar from the eminent speakers in the next 2.5 hours or so. And I'm confident that we are going to have a very entertaining session this evening. So thank you all for being with us for the 2-day program. And special thanks to the speakers for enriching us with different aspects of knowledge and for contributing in the teaching learning process in a big way. So thank you all, and over to the coordinator for the next course of the program.
I want to express my heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee, our principal sir, for his endless support and encouragement. Thank you, sir. Thank you again. I am honored to organize this webinar in association with Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Ramshodai College. So I would like to request coordinator of IQAC to deliver their speech, Mr. Subroto Roy Choudhury.
Everybody, I am honored being a part of this 2-day international webinar on health issues and social status of women. And I am thankful to full team of organizers for giving me this platform to represent ICAC of Ramshodai College as the coordinator. First of all, I would like to convey my sincere thanks to the principal of Ramshodai College, Amta, and to the principal of Shampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, whose continuous support and encouragement make this program possible. I would like to convey my sincere gratitude to Dr. Deepthendu Chatterjee, Deputy Registrar of the University of Calcutta, and Dr. Upala Borua, Head of the Department and Associate Professor of Department of Anthropology, Cotton University, as the chief guests of this webinar. I would also convey my appreciations to the speakers for their deep discussion on the topics. Today is second day of this webinar, and I am so enriched after listening yesterday's lectures. I convey my extreme gratitude to Dr. Arup Ratan Bandopadhyay for his yesterday's lecture on polycystic ovarian syndrome, or PCOS. He has revealed so many facts about PCOS, which was really unknown to most of us. I also convey my deepest gratitude to all the speakers from Serbia, Dr. Tanya Pavlica, Dr. Biljana Esrodić-Galić, and Dr. Mirjana Udici for their beautiful collaborative presentation about breast cancer of females. They have opened up new insights to us about breast cancer. I would like to welcome our 2-day speakers, Dr. Sutapa Choudhury and Mr. Saurabh Ghosh, who are going to deliver their lecture in the coming technical session. And last but not the least, I would like to thank all the faculty members of Department of Anthropology of both the colleges to organize this beautiful and meaningful webinar. And especially to the joint conveners, Ms. Soumita Chatterjee and Sheikh Hidayat Hossain, who are the real architect of this program. I wish them success in every aspect of their academic journey, and my mental and physical support will always be for such kind of endeavors in near future?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your appreciation. Now I would like to request one of our organizing committee members, Mr. Shantanu Kundu, to introduce our chief guest. Over to you, Shantanu.
I would like to introduce our chief guest, Dr. Utpala Borua. She is currently working as an associate professor and head in the Department of Anthropology of Cotton University of Assam with her specialization, Social Cultural Anthropology. She is a member of Academic Council of Cotton University and Executive Council of Cotton University. Also, the member of governing body of Northeast Council for Social Science Research, Shillong. She has more than 28 years of teaching experience in the realm of anthropology. She has already been completed 3 research projects on the mortuary practice of plain Karabi of Assam in its various forms, problem prospects and challenges of healthcare system among the tribes of Assam, and the relevance and effectiveness of the indigenous village council in terms of their functioning under the backdrop of growth of local government institutions of Assam. She has presented more than 25 national and international seminars and conferences. No need to say that she has been published numerous research papers in reputed national and international journals, as well as book chapters and books too. 7 PhD researchers are already awarded, and more than 2 researchers are working on their PhD thesis under her supervision. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce the eminent speaker like you. Now, I would like to request you, madam, to start your deliberation. The screen is yours.
Thank you, Shantanu. Namaskar. Good evening to you all. It's indeed a unique experience for me to attend this international webinar organized in close cooperation between 2 anthropology departments of 2 great institutes in the suburbs of the historic city of Kolkata, a city I always loved and cherished since my childhood. I'm really moved. Thank you, Ram Shodhoy College, Amta, and Shampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya for inviting me to address this August e-gathering. As a chief guest, and I'm really overwhelmed because amidst so many honored guests and participants, I'm really honored. Status of women, as we all know, have been one of the major themes of anthropology and almost all the social sciences and humanities. But as Shomita had rightly pointed out, studies on women have always formed the most sensitive part of each and every discipline. This is because whether it is in the West or in the East or India, women have always lived in some sort of subordination, which is difficult for any society to admit openly. In continuation with Shomita's inaugural speech lecture, I would like to point out one. I was touched when I was just reading about Kamakhya, that is in Guwahati, my city. I was just reading about this Kalika Purana and some other Yogini Tantra. Then I found that it's very interesting or significant that before offering worship, before going to worship Kamakhya Devi, that is the goddess, the mother goddess Kamakhya, One, there is a tag there, little tag, that is patriarchal tag. I feel that one, the pilgrim has to take permission from her husband, Mahadeva. And the temple of Mahadeva lies a little away in the, while the Kamakhya hill lies on the bank of the river Brahmaputra, but the temple of Mahadeva lies, Shadashiva, lies in Umananda. It's a very little island in the river Brahmaputra. So one, the pilgrim has to offer prayer to the, offer actually take permission from her husband to come and worship the mother goddess Kamakhya. So there is a tag there. If the pilgrim cannot go to the, if the pilgrim cannot go to the cross, the Ugra, what is called the Shiva temple, the, so there is within the Brahmaputra river, so there is a, within the Kamakhya complex, there is another Shiva temple where one has to take permission. So this is a tag, patriarchal tag. I felt that was attached during the medieval period or so. That I'm just sharing this idea with you. But when speaking about the status of women, we must admit that it is not a unidimensional concept, but women hold a configuration of statuses associated with their different roles, which change through time and change through the course of their lives, from childhood to, from infancy, childhood, adolescence, young women, and then elderly women. And International Labour Organization, ILO, have identified 7 major roles that women enact in the society, and status is related to these 7 roles. And these roles are parental role, the role as mother, domestic role, role as the house, the domestic role, then the conjugal role, the role of the wife, kin role, role as a relative, then community role, role that play women play in the community, then occupational role, if they have any occupation, and individual role, the, as one, an individual, she has her own role. So these are the 7 roles, and for enacting, for understanding the status, there are certain, they have spelled out certain indicators such as access to information or knowledge, extent of time spent, then extent of freedom, power of decision making regarding their roles in different spheres, extent of help received while discharging the roles, then control over resources for enacting these interrelated but diverse, 7 diverse roles for assessing the status of women. And some of them, some of our students might be interested. So it's a it's done by Opong and Abu, 1985. It's there. Yes, from what we have learned from yesterday's proceedings also on health issues of women from Professor Pratham Bandhupadhyay of Kolkata University, who is like my younger brother to me, and because, and an esteemed team of professors from Serbia on obesity and breast cancer among women, we are sufficiently enriched with the knowledge that women's health issues are closely related to the status and empowerment of women. And also, this points to the fact that gender disparity, subjugation of women continues. And we are to wait perhaps for another century to completely wipe this out from this world. I feel in this context that we need to talk more about chalking out plan for the future. We need to address the issue of women of different age groups across different regions, community, socio-economic, socio-cultural, and educational milieu. Today, I'm eagerly waiting to listen to my dear sister, Dr. Shutapa Chaudhary of University of Kolkata on women's rights vis-a-vis the Indian Constitution and emerging young historian, Mr. Saurabh Ghosh from the University of California on the problem of studying gender in medieval India. This is a very important area of research. Thus, this international webinar is a confluence of different disciplines shedding light on the gender issues or status of women throughout history and from biocultural perspectives, reflecting on the holistic perspective of anthropology as a discipline. But we have miles to go, and there is an urgent need to prioritize our research focuses, our thinking patterns. Then we'll have to identify our targets, and I hope this webinar will bring before us the works remain to be done, and it is high time to prepare a roadmap to reach gender equity and then gender equality. To my mind, this would be the best possible course of coursework in the direction of women empowerment. I wish the webinar a great success. My best wishes to both the colleges, and hope to visit both the colleges someday offline. Thank you so much. Now, yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you again. Now, I would like to request one of our organizing committee members, Dr. Arup Dhara, to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Saurabh Ghosh, to start our technical session.
Good evening, everybody.
Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, you are Hello. Audible.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Yes, you are audible. You can start.
Good evening, everybody. Today is the last day of 2-day long international webinar on health issues and social status of women. In the first technical session, we have with us most energetic and youngest speaker, Mr. Saurabh Ghosh. He will deliver his lecture on the birth of a legend, Rani Durgavati, and the problem of studying gender in medieval India. Mr. Ghosh did his master's and MPhil in history from Jadavpur University, Kolkata. Presently, he is a research scholar in the Department of History at University of California, Berkeley. His areas of research interest are history of religion, civilizations, and cultures of the Indian subcontinent, international relations, etc. He is the recipient of Junior Research Fellowship, American Institute of Indian Studies, the Barbara and Thomas Metcalf Graduate Student Fellowship, UC Berkeley, Department of History Fellowship for Graduate Study, UC Berkeley, the Bhattacharya Research Grant, Institute of South Asia Study, UC Berkeley, the American Institute of Indian Studies Summer Travel Award. He has more than 6 years of research experience, and in this period, he had worked with several premier organizations like National Archives, New Delhi, the Lokmanya Tilak Museum, Pune, the Asiatic Society of Calcutta, National Library of India, Kolkata, and Archives of Gondi Public Trust, Mantla, Madhya Pradesh. He is a member of the Medieval Academy of America and also associated with Mates of Friday Reading Group, Jadavpur University, Histories of South Asia Working Group, University of California, Berkeley, Bazam-e-Adab, a weekly Urdu reading group, and Baharistan, a reading group for classical Persian. Mr. Ghosh has authored some productive research articles in different reputed journals. He also acts as an invited panelist in different panel discussions. Journey of his life from Ghatal to Berkeley has already been published in famous Bengali daily newspaper Anandbazar Pottika on 8 November 2016. Therefore, formal introduction is not sufficient for the scholar like Saurabh Ghosh. Try to get to know him through his speeches. Without sparing too much time and with these few words, I would like to welcome Mr. Saurabh Ghosh to deliver his lecture. Mr. Ghosh, now over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the generous introduction. I'd like to share my screen with you. Can you see the screen? Hold on a second. Okay. Give me a second. Sorry. Thank you for the generous introduction. I'm grateful to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share my work. This paper is part of my MPhil dissertation. So I'd like to take a moment to thank all the people who have seen this project develop over the years. This project couldn't have been possible without the support and guidance of Professor Tilotama Mukherjee at the Department of History, Jadavpur University. I'd also like to thank my professors in Jadavpur and Berkeley. I undertook my research in the archives of the Gondi Public Trust in Mandla, the library of Rani Durgavati University in Jabalpur, the Asiatic Society, and the National Library in Kolkata. I thank all the staff in these institutions, especially I'm indebted to Mr. Girija Shankar Agarwal at the Gondi Public Trust and Professor Subhash Chandra Sharma at the Rani Durgavati University. I'm also thankful to the members of the NGO Pradhan in Karanjia and Betul. This research was supported by now defunct UGC non-net fellowship. Thanks are also due to Aparajita Dash, Shevya Mishra, and Amrita Chattopadhyay for helping me arrange this presentation. Anurag Advani and Mariam Sabri have been a constant source of inspiration. Finally, I dedicate this presentation to my friends and well-wisher. You know who you are. The major part of my lecture will deal with the politics and conditions that produced the many legends of Rani Durgavati. In other words, we have very few sources on Durgavati from her time of rule. Here, I will illustrate how her tale was produced and retold by the colonial scholars to construct a particular narrative of Indian history. Using the same foil, the anti-colonial nationalist literature also produced its own version of Durgavati. And finally, I will show how the memory of Durgavati is playing a central role in the realm of women empowerment and identity formation among the Adivasis in present-day Central India. By way of conclusion, I will spend the last few minutes analyzing the problems and challenges of studying gender in medieval India. Apart from extensive ethnography in Madhya Pradesh, for my research, I have used translated Persian text, literature written in Sanskrit, Hindi, Bangla, and material produced in English by the colonial officers and scholars. In early 2012, I, as a researcher from Kolkata, was interested in the study of gender and power in Mughal Empire. I often wondered,
sir, sorry to interrupt you. Are you sharing your screen?
Yes.
It's not visible here.
Oh.
Okay, now it's showing. Now it's showing.
Okay,
you can continue.
Sorry
now.
About
Thank
that.
You.
Sorry about that. Okay, so in early 2012, I, as a researcher from Kolkata, was interested in the study of gender and power in the Mughal Empire. I often wondered, why don't we have any powerful Mughal women ruler? We do have an example of a woman ruler from the Delhi Sultanate. Razia Sultana ruled for 4 years during the 13th century as the heir to Mamluk ruler Iltutmish. But no Mughal woman ever rose to the occasion. However, that doesn't mean that women were marginal to Mughal politics. Quite the opposite. The research of Ruby Lal and Munis Faruqi, among others, show the crucial role women played in the Mughal world. My quest for powerful women rulers from the Mughal period took me to the 16th century Gond ruler Rani Durgavati. A simple Google search showed me how Rani Durgavati is celebrated in different parts of central India, particularly in the eastern part of Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. In September 2012, I began to think more about my research, and a trip to Jabalpur became imminent. Here, I'd like to take a pause and try to analyze my subject position as a scholar of medieval gender history. The textbook and popular narrative of Muslim rule in India in general and Mughal rule in particular are full of references to despotic Muslim rulers. They are supposed lust for Rajput, or often broadly categorized Hindu woman, is a well-known theme in Indian history. It is also believed that the condition of women reached an all-time low under the Muslim rule in India. I intended to analyze and examine this textbook knowledge through my research on gender question in Mughal India. However, since I did not know Persian back then, I had to venture beyond the Mughal courtly circle. The fact that my understanding of gender history in medieval India essentially brought me to Rani Durgavati is, however, no coincidence or accidental, as it might seem otherwise. In school textbooks, we frequently see Padmavati, Durgavati, Tarabai, and Ahallabai Holkar as exemplary Hindu women from the medieval period. So they are recognized as part of an unbroken Hindu tradition that goes back to the great Hindu women from the Vedic period, Gopa, Opala, Gargi, and Maitri. Durgavati is noted for her bravery and military prowess. Moreover, since she fought against the Mughal army and died on the battlefield, she is often interpreted as the symbol of Hindu resistance against the Muslim rulers. I was aware of the problem of this mainstream narrative that analyzes medieval history through the lens of an inherent Hindu-Muslim conflict and animosity. Plus, I also was exposed to recent researches in the field that challenges this popular perception based on older scholarship. However, as a researcher, I was also looking for great women from the pages of history. In doing so, I was participating in a century-old scholarly tradition that privileges exemplary women figures from Indian history to explain the status of women. I was at the tail end of a long list of Orientalist and nationalist scholars who, as a method, used the lives of great personalities to trace and analyze historical change over time. The difference, however, was my training as a scholar of history and my intention behind the research. To sum up, to me, without realizing it, in the initial days of research, the study of gender was synonymous with great women in history. This is a problem that I will address at the end of this talk. But before that, I would like to take a minute to lay out the basic framework of my talk today. I begin by tracing the history of Durgavati, the legend, from 1564 to 2014. I will show how Durgavati became a national and regional icon in the last 450 years. For me, this journey started with my first trip to Jabalpur in the September of 2012. In the absence of a robust secondary scholarship on Durgavati, I knew little about her and went to Jabalpur with an open mind to learn more about Durgavati's life and legacy. The image in the slide is the biggest statue. The image in the slide is the biggest statue of Rani Durgavati in the city of Jabalpur. Be it Rani Durgavati University, hospital, or other government establishment, the imprint of Durgavati's memory over the city space of Jabalpur is numerous. This is an image I encountered everywhere during my trip to Jabalpur in 2012. During this trip, I also met the professors in the history department of Rani Durgavati University to learn more about the scholarly works on the subject. And they pointed me towards two master's theses and a monograph by Dr. Suresh Mishra. They were useful to the extent that I learned some crucial facts about Durgavati's life. But in the absence of a robust textual archive, I thought of turning to ethnography as my research method. Singhorgarh, a suburb of Jabalpur, is noted for Rani Ki Kila, the fort of the queen. The fort is situated in the woods and not easily accessible to the outsiders. On my way back from the fort, I met some of the locals who identified themselves as the Gonds, one of the Adivasi communities in the region. When I stated the reason behind my visit to the fort, one of the oldest people came forward and started reciting couplets extolling the bravery of Rani Durgavati and her achievement as a Gond ruler. My knowledge of standardized modern Hindi was not enough to fathom the couplets. They kindly explained some words that I was unfamiliar with. Thus, within 2 days, I experienced two different sides of Durgavati. In post-independent India, Durgavati has become an inseparable entity of the city of Jabalpur, the erstwhile colonial outpost in central India. At the same time, the memory of Durgavati occupies a major part in the Gond oral narrative. My project tries to explain the process through which Rani Durgavati came to enjoy this illustrious afterlife almost 4.5 centuries after her death. The third Mughal emperor, Akbar's close associate and key Mughal ideologue Abul Fazl, in his Akbarnama, briefly describes how Gadha was annexed. Here, for the first time, we find a reference to Rani Durgavati. We find similar references from two other Persian sources from the same period, Tabakat-e-Akbari and Tarikh-e-Firista. A brief note about Rani Durgavati and Gondwana Kingdom based on these 16th century sources would be helpful for our purpose. Durgavati hailed from Chandel Rajput family. Following her marriage with the Gond King Dalpat Shah, she came to Gadha, the center of Gadha-Katanga Kingdom. To be clear, the caste identity of the rulers of Gondwana is disputed to this day. After the premature death of her husband, Dalpat Shah, Durgavati became the regent ruler of the kingdom. She ruled Gadha from 1550 to 1564 until her death as a regent to her son Veer Narayan. Asaf Khan, the Mansabdar or Mughal general of neighboring Kara Manikpur, invaded Gadha, and in a battle lasting no more than 2 days, Gadha was annexed to the Mughal Empire. Abul Fazl does mention the bravery of Durgavati in the battle. He also noted the apparent affluence of the kingdom. A hold over this part of Gondwana was crucial for the Mughals. The region was noted for its reserve of valuable minerals and wild elephants. The significance of the elephant in Mughal warfare is well known. However, due to the uneven landscape and thick forests, ruling Gondwana was a difficult task for North India-based Mughal power. Within two decades, separate small Gond kingdoms emerged in the region who maintained tributary relations with the Mughals. From the mid-17th century text, Adabi Alamgiri, we find Mughal Prince Aurangzeb's letter to Gond kings asking them for elephants in tribute. Tributary Gond rulers following Durgavati maintained their suzerainty in the region, sharing their sovereignty with the Mughals. Akbarnama by Abul Fazl is a monumental Mughal text, and the scholars of medieval history have repeatedly shown its role in depicting Mughal imperial ambition. The textual reference to the battle between Durgavati and Mughal army support the historical authenticity of the event. Rani Durgavati became a local legend soon after her tragic death in the war against the Mughals. To the people of the region, she was the key historical figure and the most important sovereign. The Mughals were no local rivals, and the people of the region recognized that it was the prosperity of their kingdom during the rule of Durgavati that attracted even distant enemies. The written sources from the 17th and 18th century are few, and some were only discovered after the annexation of Central India by East India Company in the early 19th century. In 1784, there were two unrelated historical developments that are crucial for our study. The Marathas annexed Gondwana Kingdom, and the Ascetic Society was established in Calcutta. The Ascetic Society, as a colonial institution, played a major role in the annotation, translation, and publication of Sanskrit, Persian, Arabic, and literature in other Indian languages. Eric Stokes, in his monograph, English Utilitarian in India, has shown how scholars come administrator of East India Company took keen interest on Indian culture and tradition. This mammoth Oriental scholarship has major bearing to our study. Gadesha Nipa Varnanam, a Sanskrit composition, provides details of the Gondwana rulers. The text was composed soon after the demise of Gondwana kingdom at the hands of the Marathas. The text, however, did not put Durgavati at its center. Rather, it said that Veer Narayan ruled the kingdom for 15 years with the help of his mother and other ministers. In the first half of the 19th century, Ramnagar inscription was discovered and translated into English. This was a period when Indology was a celebrated discipline, and discovery of a Sanskrit inscription in a relatively less populated area of India was a great success for the Indologists and archaeologists of the time. Since Sanskrit was seen as the emblem of a glorious Hindu civilization, the discovery of Ramnagar inscription and the existence of titular rulers in this territory triggered the search for a glorious past Hindu kingdom in these highlands. The inscription depicts Rani Durgavati as one of the most important sovereigns of the kingdom, who fought the hardest battles and sacrificed her life for the sake of her honor and of the kingdom. The English translation of this inscription by E. Fell was published in Asiatic Researches in 1825. It was subsequently republished by Fitz Edward Hall and Alexander Cunningham in 1860 and in 1881-82. Another manuscript named Gadesha Nipa Vandana Sloka Sangraha was discovered by G. V. Vave in 1940s from Mandla. It is a compilation of works of various poets of the region starting from the 16th to 18th century. By now, all the essential qualities of a just and able ruler had been added to the charismatic personality, the charismatic personality of Rani Durgavati. Her martial capabilities, benevolence, and biasness all were included to the verses. So what we see here is an existing tradition that depicts Durgavati as an ideal ruler of the Gaura kingdom. What is missing from this tradition is a religiously charged narrative of how Durgavati fought on behalf of a Hindu civilization against the Mughal Muslim rulers, a narrative that developed in the 19th and 20th centuries, to which now we turn. Following the Third Anglo-Maratha War in 1817 and 1818, Central India came under direct British administration. W.H. Sleeman was one of the first authors who provided valuable information about the Gondwana Kingdom. He was stationed in Central India for long and was famous for the abolition of Thagi. The discovery of Ramnagar inscription inspired a number of authors to look into the history of the Gondwana Kingdom, and Sleeman was one of them. His article titled History of the Garhmandala Rajas was published in the Journal of Aesthetic Society in 1837. He was the first colonial writer to document the celebrated resistance of Rani Durgavati to the army of the Mughal commander Asaf Khan. The search for an authentic past of the region was thus initiated with the historical writings on Gondwana Kingdom. Among all the rulers, the character of Rani Durgavati was highlighted due to her strong resistance against the Muslim invaders. Moreover, unlike the other Gond rulers, the Rajput identity of Durgavati was not disputed. Thus, soon Durgavati became another example of Rajput chivalry and martial attributes that ruled the colonial discourse about India's past. When Sleeman wrote this article, two path-breaking works on Indian history were already published: The History of British India by James Mill in 1818 and James Todd's Annals and Antiquities of Rajasthan in 1829. These two works majorly shaped the colonial historiography of India's past. These writings encouraged and set the mood for generations of writers on Indian history. The Dark Age thesis that Mill propounded represented ancient India as the glorious Hindu Age, and also suggested that medieval Muslim rule was the age of tyranny, lawlessness, and anarchy. He blamed the Muslim rulers for the Dark Age and in the glorious history of India. His work championed the colonial project of recovering the glorious Hindu civilization. Similarly, James Todd depicted the Rajputs as the ideal patriotic martial race of India. They were regarded as the true sons of the soil, who single-handedly fought against the foreign Muslim oppressors to save their independence and honor of the Indian nation. The key words that Sleeman uses to narrate Durgavati are derived from these works. In the whole essay, Sleeman uses terms like Rajput, Mohammedan, and women again and again. In his account, he shows that the Rajput heritage of Durgavati gave her the courage to fight against the tyrannical Mohammedan Mughal ruler. Sleeman imitated the celebrated colonial understanding of Indian history that was developing in the first half of the 19th century. Following Sleeman, in subsequent colonial writings, Durgavati will get represented as the warrior of the Hindu civilization. The pre-colonial literature on Durgavati gets a new twist in the writings of the colonial scholars. This standard narrative on Durgavati will get reproduced repeatedly in official monographs, poetries, or in archaeological reports of the region through the 19th century. Before we go into the next slide and discuss the ways in which nationalist literature would represent Durgavati, let's take a moment to analyze the problems with the colonial narrative on Durgavati. There are a couple of issues with this narrative. First of all, the annexation of Gondwana was not a planned one. Mughal Central Force was not involved in it. It was an act of aggression by an ambitious Mansabdar, Asaf Khan. Secondly, the role of the Rajputs in medieval period was quite opposite to what colonial writers had imagined. Recent scholarship with substantial evidence has shown how Rajput functioned as the biggest ally to the Mughals and reaped the maximum benefit from the Mughal rule. Next, colonial narrative on Durgavati is based on the theory of invasion. This narrative takes India as a fixed territorial entity since the ancient period. In doing so, it asserts that India was a closed territorial entity and was subject to repeated invasions from the outside forces. The works of Monu Goswami and others show how the idea of India as a territorial entity got produced in the latter half of the 19th century. The idea of a linear border was absent for the period that we are discussing here. In such a context, it is difficult to define what did India mean to the rulers and ruled in the 16th century. Or, for that matter, in the absence of a linear boundary, how do we decide who was insider and who was outsiders? Finally, unlike the colonial rulers, the Mughals and the Muslim rulers before them intermarried with other communities and castes and settled in the Indian subcontinent. By the time Akbar came to power, Muslim presence in Indian subcontinent was already more than 700 years old. The question then is, how long does it take for a certain group of people to become native to a certain place? Starting in the last decades of the 19th century, three British presidencies, Calcutta, Madras, and Bombay, were becoming the center of anti-colonial mobilization. It culminated in Bengal in the form of a mass movement in opposition to Lord Curzon's decision to partition the province. The anti-colonial nationalism harked back to the glorious past of India. According to the nationalist narrative, the celebrated past was disrupted again and again by the invaders. The idea that India is essentially a tolerant Hindu nation was created in the process. The primordial character of India as a Hindu nation and Muslims as the other of that nation was repeatedly asserted through this canon of patriotic literature. Thus, the nationalist author took the colonial sociology of knowledge about the Indian past and Hindu civilization and superimposed it to their narrative of nation. Enormous amount of patriotic novel, stories, poetry, essays in Bangla were published during this period. New narratives on various historical personalities were produced and reproduced to evoke patriotism among the masses. Shivaji, Rana Pratap, Prithviraj Chauhan became the new heroes of the nation. They were represented as the savior of Hindu tradition and culture of Indian nation in the past. Anti-colonial nationalism sought women's participation in freedom movement. Here too, the tale of Durgavati's resistance to the Mughal army was seen as an exemplary instance. The militant nationalist needed such iconic figures as opposed to the passive ideal Hindu woman. The example of brave women from India's past were retold to inspire them. In particular, Bengal was one of the main centers of violent nationalist activities. At a time when Mother Goddess Kali was becoming the icon for the upper caste Hindu revolutionary nationalists, the newly produced narrative of Durgavati in the 19th century fit well to their cause. She soon came to be identified as a Virangana, a newly formed nationalist category for the empowered Hindu woman. As the list of books in the slide shows, by the 20th century, Durgavati's tale was getting retold in different languages in different parts of India. She was no longer just a queen of Garha, as we saw in the pre-colonial Persian and Sanskrit sources. By the turn of the 20th century, she had come to occupy the national space in the writings of colonial scholars and Indian nationalists. The tradition of celebrating Durgavati continued in post-independent India. Anand Pai, in 1967, started publishing Amar Chitra Katha, the immortal comics of India. The comic series depicted the lives of famous characters from Hindu mythology, important historical personalities, patriots, and social reformers from the 19th and 20th centuries India. The comic book on Durgavati appeared in 1976. The Indian state acknowledged her bravery by honoring a stamp in her name in 1988. And yet, after independence, the role of Durgavati as an icon also resurfaced in a different context in central India. Here, from the late 20th century, she has gradually become a Gond and an Adivasi icon. Gondwana Ganatantra Party and Gond Mahasabha are the two organizations who are reclaiming Durgavati as the Gond queen and an inseparable element to their ethnic identity. The two images in the slides here represents two different avatars of Rani Durgavati. Let's look at the image on the right first. The stark difference between the ruler and the ruled is evident. The Rajput identity of the queen is highlighted. She is shown here as the rescuer and savior of her Gond subject. The Gonds have been represented here following the mainstream Adivasi stereotype. On the other hand, on the image on the right, we see a statue of Durgavati in Kachargarh in Maharashtra. Here, one can see the flag of Gondwana Ganatantra Party behind the statue. Additionally, by writing Jai Seva 750, the chant of Gond community, they are reclaiming Durgavati as their queen and making a case for their historical claim over the region. The valor of Durgavati is often compared to the deity Durga in Bundelkhand and Narmada region. The cult of Hindu mythic gods and goddesses is not unknown to a large section of Gond populations, where Durga is recognized as the symbol of bravery. The name of the queen herself leads to such a comparison. The above couplet in the slide is from a popular folk song that describes Mughal Gondwana encounter. It narrates that Rani Durgavati ordered her maid to imprison Akbar and he became a captive of her. This incident never happened if we are to believe textual evidence of the Mughal Gondwana encounter. Akbar never visited Gondwana and Durgavati was defeated in a battle lasting only 2 days. So the possibility of such an occurrence was almost impossible. The folk song can be read as a regional response to the historical reality of Mughal Gondwana encounter. This song is part of a folklore tradition called Gondwani, the one that I heard when I went to Jabalpur for the first time. These folk songs are very different from the colonial and national narrative of Durgavati. They are locally rooted and play particular functions in the ritual and social life of Gonds in central India. In other words, these retellings deny the Hindu overtone of Durgavati narrative. In doing so, Gond and the other Adivasis are resisting the process of Hinduization and reclaiming Durgavati from her national avatar. The narrative of a Hindu-Muslim encounter is marginal to the Gond retelling of Durgavati. Akbar and Durgavati, as the above folk song depicts, are seen as political opponents and not the representative of Hindu-Muslim encounter. The mainstream narrative of Durgavati developed out of some existing historical sources. They were blended with the deep sense of anti-colonial nationalism of the 19th and 20th century. The problem is how far the character of Rani Durgavati can be seen as an example of empowered womanhood. From a feminist perspective, Christine Lane Garlock has argued that the representation of the Viranganas actually deny an ordinary women's history. Badri Narayan, in the context of North India, have shown how lower caste women characters such as Dhalkari Bai and Uda Devi have become the symbols of Dalit and women emancipation. In case of the indigenous women organizations of Central India, we witness a different phenomenon. The women organizations are reclaiming Rani Durgavati as an Adivasi icon for women empowerment. The Gonds and other Adivasi communities in Central India are resisting a totalizing national narrative of Rani Durgavati. The Rajput image of Rani Durgavati is facing an immense competition from the local Gond socio-political organization. The iconization of Rani Durgavati is an exceptional instance where a high caste Virangana is getting claimed by the Adivasi population and becoming a symbol of their political expressions. Initially, her iconography was only restricted among the Gonds, but now she is gradually being incorporated as an Adivasi icon from the region. The state and central governments are also utilizing her icon to address the Adivasis. Since 2003, Madhya Pradesh government has introduced a self-employment venture for the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe unemployed women called Rani Durgavati Swarojgar Yojana. Grassroots women organizations in present-day Central India are also taking on Durgavati's narrative to spread the awareness about gender equality and women emancipation. Rani Durgavati Mahila Sangh and Jai Seva Rani Durgavati Adivasi Mahila Mandal are two such organizations who are working for women emancipation among the Gonds and other Adivasi communities in Central India. They are fighting against the gender inequality in working sectors, domestic violence, literacy, among other things. This entire research was a journey for me where I discovered the multi-layered narrative of a queen's life across space and time. The illustrious afterlives of Durgavati that we just covered does not, however, answer the problem that we have in hand. How do we study gender in a period where we do not have enough historical sources? And in most of the cases, they are written by the men in power for other men. How do we recover women's voices from such an archive? The study of great women, to reiterate Garlock's point, deny the life stories of ordinary women from medieval period. Thus, beyond quote, we have limited literature on women in medieval period. Along with celebrating and recovering the great women narrative, we need to ask a different set of questions. For example, what was the role of gender in ordering the society? How did gender function at the level of deep structure of politics, society, and culture in medieval period? Borrowing Uma Chakraborty's celebrated essay, we also need to ask whatever happened to the ordinary women in Mughal period. That will give us a better perspective on the condition of women in medieval period. The books on the slides give us some foray into the world of women in medieval Indian history. Particularly, Farhat Hassan, by using Qazi court documents, have shown the possibility of recovering voices of ordinary women from the archive. We, as the historians of medieval India, need to borrow methodological insights from anthropology, art history, literary theory, gender studies, queer theory, and other disciplines, and extend our archives in order to reconstruct the lives of women for the period where our standard historical method appears inadequate. I would like to end this presentation with a Urdu couplet by Munir Niazi and make a case for asking the right sets of questions when it comes to gender in Indian history. Kisi ko apne amal ka hisab kya dete, sawal sare galat the, jawab kya dete. Thank you for your presence. I look forward to your questions, comments, and insights.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. I, on the behalf of the organizing committee, express my gratitude to Saurabh Ghosh, sir, for delivering such a wonderful and knowledgeable teach. I think it will enrich us in our intellectual sphere. Thank you again. Some questions are arised from our learned audience. I would like to forward these questions to our respected speaker one by one. Sir, the first question is from Dibbojyoti Ganguly. Importance of the present study on Durgavati in postmodern social science.
Could you please repeat the question again?
Okay. Importance of the present study on Durgavati in postmodern social science. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, I was having a little trouble with the
Okay.
Yeah, I think you're froze. Anyway, so I think studying Durgavati explains. So Durgavati is a window. Hello.
Yes, sir. You can continue.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I think Durgavati for me is a window to understand how perception about women changed over time and how the idea about femininity got constructed in the course of 19th and 20th century and how it changed. So the idea that Virangana being an empowered woman needs this and Patibrata as an empowered woman needs this, like these ideas are constructed in the 19th and 20th century. So we have Padmavati, Durgavati. So Padmavati is the Patibrata. So I think our analysis of Durgavati explains our present society and the gender stereotype that exist. So if you pick up a newspaper, encounter this term.
Hello. I think there's some technical problem. Saurabh sir, can you hear me?
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Now, okay, you can continue. Hello, Saurabh sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay.
Yeah, I can hear you now.
I think there's some network problem over there, sir. Hello. Hello, Saurabh sir. Can you hear me? Hello. Hello, sir.
I think there is some network issue from the Saurabh sir's side.
Okay.
You can continue.
Okay. Now, thank you so much, sir. Now, I would like to request Dibbojyoti Ganguly to introduce our next speaker. Over to you, Dibbojyoti.
Thank you, Bhagyashree. It's my great fortune to introduce my teacher, who always enlightened us during our postgraduate studies in University of Calcutta. So now I am so glad to introduce Dr. Shutapa Mukhchaudhuri ma'am. Now she is currently working as associate professor in Department of Anthropology, University of Calcutta, with a specialization in social cultural anthropology. She obtained her PhD from Department of Anthropology, University of Calcutta in 2006. And she started her journey as assistant professor in the Department of Anthropology in Vivekananda College for Women. And then she joined as assistant professor in Department of Anthropology in University of Calcutta on 2004. Her interest in research basically focused on criminology, women's studies, ethnoarchaeology, heritage management, urban anthropology, informal economy, ethnography, and indigenous cultural studies. An enormous volume of research publications in several reputed as well as very prestigious national and international journals are there. Dr. Shutapa Chaudhuri is a life member of Indian Science Congress Association, Indian Anthropological Society, and more than 5 scholars are still working under her supervision. I'm so glad to, and I'm eagerly waiting to hear you, ma'am. So please, this is my humble request to you to kindly stir to your deliberation to enlighten us. Thank you. Over to you, ma'am. Please continue. Ma'am, please. Ma'am, there is some problem. We can't hear you, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm audible now. Hello?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Dibbojyoti. Before I begin, I would like to thank the organizers of this 2 days international webinar for inviting me to deliver talk on one of the most important issues of all time that needs to be addressed, that is the rights of women in the society. I would try to portray a picture of how our own constitution addresses women's rights. Human beings possess certain basic rights by virtue of being born as a human. These rights are inherent in all individuals, irrespective of their gender, anywhere in the world. These are the rights which provide them with the means to live a life with dignity and fundamental freedom. During the early Vedic period, women enjoyed equal status with men. Works by Patanjali and Katayana show that women were educated in the early Vedic period. Rig Veda verses suggest that women were looked upon with respect in the society. Our ancient texts also refer to many women scholars like Gargi and Maitreyi. Unfortunately, through the ages, the society dynamics in almost every part of the world underwent such phenomenal changes that the status of women has been subject to many changes. Deep-rooted customs in male-dominated societies took a heavy toll of the status of women, and they were relegated to such tertiary roles in the society that they forgot to live with human dignity and fundamental freedom. The state affairs continued during the medieval period and further deteriorated during the Muslim rule. Notwithstanding many objectionable decisions adopted by the British rulers, British rule infused many illuminating Western ideas into the country. Encouraged by the rays of knowledge radiating from the West, a few enlightened Indians such as Raja Ram Mohan Rai, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, Swami Vivekananda, Acharya Abhinoba Bhave, Jyotirao Phule, and a few more worked for the upliftment of the status of women in India. Through their untiring efforts, the heinous customs of Shotidaho was abolished and the Widow Remarriage Act of 1856 was passed. Many luminaries including Savitribai Phule of Maharashtra and Sister Nivedita in Calcutta endeavored opening of schools for girls for their education. There were some enlightened women like Chandramukhi Basu and Kadambini Ganguly, who in spite of severe resistance from societal orthodoxy, achieved academic distinctions in those days. But unfortunately, these exemplary achievements could not percolate down to the grassroots level to encourage other women due to the traditional orthodox mindset of the male-dominated society. During freedom movement, almost all the leaders of the struggle were of the view that women should be given equal status with men in free India, and all types of discriminatory practices against women should stop. And for that to happen, it was thought fit to include such provisions in the Constitution of India, which would help eliminate age-old exploitative customs and traditions, and also include such provisions which would help in empowering women in all spheres of social activities. With the passing of the Indian Independence Act 1947, the Constituent Assembly, formed earlier in the Cabinet Mission Plan in November 1946, became a sovereign body. Some of the important members of this Constituent Assembly were Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Sardar Patel, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, Gobind Vallabh Pant, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. The draft constitution was first published in January 1948. The people of India discussed the draft for 8 months and proposed hundreds of amendments. The Constituent Assembly adopted the new Constitution of India on 26th November 1949. The date of commencement of the Constitution of India is 26th January 1950. The Constitution of India is a living instrument with capabilities of enormous dynamism. It is a constitution made for a progressive society and a welfare state. The principle of gender equality is enshrined in the Indian Constitution in its preamble, fundamental rights, directive principles of state policy, and fundamental duties. The Constitution provides equality to men and women. It also empowers the state to adopt measures of positive discrimination in favor of women. Within the framework of a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, the constitutional goal has been to empower women in all spheres of activities in life. Part 3 of the Constitution of India deals with the fundamental rights in Articles 12 to 35. This part of the Constitution of India has been very aptly described by many as the Magna Carta of India. These are the rights guaranteed for the persons, citizens, irrespective of any caste, creed, sex, religion, place of birth, etc., and are enforceable in the court of law. In Manika Gandhi versus Union of India, All India Reporter, 1978, Justice Bhagavati of the Supreme Court of India observed, I quote, "These fundamental rights represent the basic values cherished by the people of this country since the Vedic times, and they are calculated to protect the dignity of the individual and create conditions in which every human being can develop his or her personality to the fullest extent," unquote. Article 14 says, "The state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or the equal protection of the laws within the territory of India." Article 14 of the Constitution guarantees women the right to equality with men and equal protection of laws within the territory of India. Article 14 prohibits class legislation but does not forbid reasonable classification. The classification, if any, must not be arbitrary, artificial, or evasive. Article 14 demands that the classification must be based on an intelligible differentia and must have a rational relation to the object sought to be achieved by the legislation. This equality is, in fact, antithesis to arbitrariness. The Supreme Court case Vijayalakshmi versus Punjab University, 2003, relates to the appointment of a lady principal in a girls' college. Punjab University calendar in its volume 3 provided for appointment of a lady principal in women's college or a lady teacher or a lady superintendent. It was alleged that the provisions in the university calendar was violative of Article 14 of the Constitution of India. The Supreme Court held that the provision for appointment of lady principal or lady teacher exclusively in girls' college was not violative of Article 14 and 15 of the Constitution. The classification was reasonable. It had nexus with the object sought to be achieved. It was highlighted that there can be classification between male and female for certain posts. In the instead case, the object sought to be achieved was precautionary and preventive based on public morals in view of the young age of the girl students to be taught. Article 15, subclause 1 says, "The state shall not discriminate against any citizen on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them." Article 15, subclause 3 says, "Nothing in this article should prevent the state from making any special provision for women and children." Article 15, subclause 1 prohibits the state to discriminate between citizens on grounds of gender. Here, discrimination means adverse distinction. In Roghubans versus the State of Punjab, 1972, the Punjab and Haryana High Court held that a government order declaring women as ineligible for the post of warden in a men's jail is not violative of Article 15, subclause 1 of the Constitution, due to the reason that if a woman was employed as a warden, her position would become worse and hazardous in maintaining discipline over habitual offenders housed in jail. It is a kind of protective discrimination involving physical safety of women and cannot be said to be an adverse distinction. The founding fathers of the Constitution of India thought that in a society predominantly controlled by patriarchal motivations and discriminations, to elevate the status of women, some special provisions for women have to be made to guarantee equality of men and women. The dream of the constitution makers was that a welfare state will always strive by both executive and legislative action to help the less fortunate and to improve their condition, so that social inequalities accumulating through the centuries may be bridged. This was envisaged as a method of protective discrimination. Article 15, subclause 3 empowers the state to make special provisions for women. Thus, under Article 42, women workers can be given special maternity relief, and any legislation to this effect will not infringe Article 15, subclause 1. In this way, if educational institutions are established by the state exclusively for women, it should not be in violation of Article 15. In Dattatreya versus State of Bombay, 1953, the Bombay High Court held that establishment of educational college exclusively for women does not violate Article 15 of the Constitution. Article 16, subclause 1 says, there shall be equality of opportunity for all citizens in matters relating to employment or appointment to any office under the state. Article 16, subclause 2 says, no citizen shall, on grounds of only of religion, race, caste, sex, decent place of birth, residence, or any of them, be ineligible for or discriminated against in respect of any employment or office under the state, etc., etc. The Constitution provides equal opportunities for women implicitly, as they are applicable to all persons irrespective of sex. However, the society has not yet been able to accelerate the process of equality to the extent the Constitution visualized. In C.B. Muthamma versus Union of India, 1979, the petitioner C.B. Muthamma was India's first woman IFS officer. She complained of discriminatory regulations of Indian Foreign Service Rules, 1961. Some of the major issues raised by her were, 1. No married woman shall be entitled as of right to be appointed to the service. 2. A woman member was required to obtain written permission of the government before her marriage. 3. At any time after marriage, she could be asked to resign if the government was confirmed that her family and domestic commitments were coming in the way of her due and efficient discharge of duties. In a landmark judgment in 1979 delivered by a three-member bench headed by Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, it was held that henceforth it was not mandatory for women officers in IFS to seek government permission for getting married. Commenting on the third issue, the court said, the same risk is run by the government if a male member contracts a marriage. If the family and domestic commitments of a woman member of the service is likely to come in the way of efficient discharge of duties, a similar situation may arise in case of a male member. Commenting further, the court said, I quote, if a married man has a right, a married woman, other things being equal, stands on no worse footing. This misogynous posture is a hangover of the masculine culture of manacling the weaker sex, forgetting how our struggle for national freedom was also a battle against women's thraldom. Freedom is indivisible, so is justice. That our founding faith enshrined in Articles 14 and 16 should have been tragically ignored vis-a-vis half of India's humanity. It is a sad reflection on the distance between Constitution in the book and law in action. In India versus Nargesh Mirza, 1981, Nargesh Mirza, an air hostess of Air India, filed a writ petition regarding discriminatory regulations of Air India regulation. Several issues of gender discrimination were raised. Most important of them were, number one, whether termination of services of air hostesses on first pregnancy was unreasonable and arbitrary. Two, whether the procedure of extension of the age of retirement of an air hostess, quote unquote, at the option of the managing director is violative of Article 14 of the Constitution of India. The Supreme Court held that Article 14 forbids hostile discrimination, but not reasonable classification. It applies where equals are treated differently without any reasonable basis. The provision according to which the service of air hostesses would stand terminated on first pregnancy is manifestly unreasonable and arbitrary and contains the quality of unfairness. It amounts to compelling air hostesses not to have any children and thus interfere and divert the ordinary course of human nature. It is not only a callous and cruel act, but an open insult to Indian womanhood. The regulation was struck down by the Supreme Court as it was crossly violative of Article 14 of the Constitution. In regard to the second issue of extension of service after retirement at the option of the managing director, the court held that the relevant regulation confers a discretionary power without laying down any guideline or principle. It is violative of Article 14 and is liable to be struck down as unconstitutional. Article 23, subclause 1, prohibits traffic in human beings, and any contravention of it is an offense punishable in accordance with law. Traffic in human beings includes the selling and buying of women and children for immoral and other purposes. In order to address this constitutional mission, the state in 1956 enacted the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act 1956 to prevent sexual exploitation for commercial purposes. The act also laid down that the act of procuring, inducing, or taking away any woman with intention to exploit for the purpose of prostitution and other forms of trafficking, including the Devdasi system, will be recognized as an offense. In Vishaljeet versus Union of India, 1990, the Apex Court observed that the trafficking in human beings has been prevalent in India for a long time in the form of selling and purchasing of human beings for prostitution for a price just like that of vegetables. The fundamental rights guaranteed to women become meaningless unless there is some effective machinery for enforcement of these rights. If there is no remedy, there is no right at all. Article 32, subclause 1 guarantees, I quote, the right to move the Supreme Court by appropriate proceedings for enforcement of the rights, unquote, conferred by the Constitution mentioned above. Article 32 is itself a fundamental right. Article 32, subclause 2, empowers the Supreme Court to issue writs in the nature of habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, quo warranto, and certiorari. Article 226 of the Constitution of India also empowers the high courts to the writs for enforcement of fundamental rights. A question naturally arises as to who can move the Supreme Court or High Court seeking relief under Article 32. Traditionally, this right is available to those only whose fundamental rights have been infringed. However, this traditional rule has now been considerably relaxed by the Supreme Court. The court now permits public interest litigations at the instance of public-spirited citizens for the enforcement of constitutional and other legal rights. Of any person or group of persons who are socially and economically disadvantaged and are unable to move the court for relief. A few illustrative cases may be mentioned in this connection to show how it has helped women in the past. In Delhi Domestic Working Women's Forum versus Union of India 1995 Supreme Court case, a public interest litigation was filed under Article 32 on behalf of Delhi Domestic Working Women's Forum to expose the deplorable conditions of the domestic servants who were subjected to indecent sexual assault by 7 army personnel. The incident occurred in a train while these 6 women were traveling by Muri Express from Ranchi to Delhi. The apex court, while considering the entire matter, laid down a few guidelines in order to assist and award compensation to the rape victims and directed the National Commission of Women to evolve a scheme within 6 months for implementation of the parameters set forth in the guidelines. In Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan 1997, a public interest litigation was filed by Vishakha, a non-governmental organization working for gender equality, seeking enforcement of fundamental rights of working women under Articles 14, 19, and 21 of the Constitution. The immediate cause for filing the writ petition by way of the public interest litigation was the alleged brutal gang rape of a social worker of Rajasthan. The apex court laid down exhaustive guidelines for preventing sexual harassment of working women at their workplaces and directed the government to bring in appropriate legislation for the purpose. In Gaurav Chain versus Union of India 1997, a public-spirited advocate, Gaurav Chain, filed a public interest litigation seeking appropriate directions to the government for improvement of the plight of prostitutes, fallen women, and their children. The Supreme Court issued a number of directions to the government and all social organizations to take appropriate measures for preventing women in various forms of prostitution and to rescue them from falling again into the trap of red light areas, and suggest various welfare measures for providing them with the means of livelihood and socio-economic improvement. Article 39 requires the state to direct its policies towards securing economic justice to men and women equally. Article 39 says the state shall in particular direct its policy towards securing, subclause A, that the citizens, men and women, equally have the right to an adequate means of livelihood. Subclause D says that there is equal pay for equal work for both men and women. Subclause E says that the health and strength of workers, men and women, and the tender age of children are not abused, and that the citizens are not forced by economic necessity to enter avocations unsuited to their age or strength. Article 39, subclause A, directs the state to adopt its policies towards securing to all the citizens, men and women equally, adequate means of livelihood so that they can lead their lives with dignity. In pursuance of Article 39, subclause D, the Parliament has enacted the Equal Remuneration Act 1976. Although the principles laid down in the directive principles are not enforceable in a court of law, the directive contained in Article 39, subclause D, and the act passed can be judicially enforceable by court. In Randhir Singh versus Union of India, 1982, the Supreme Court held that the principle of, quote, equal pay for equal work, unquote, though not a fundamental right, is certainly a constitutional goal and therefore capable of enforcement through constitutional remedies provided under Article 32 of the Constitution. This right, although finds place in Article 39, it can be considered as an accompaniment of equality clause enshrined in Articles 14 and 16 of the Constitution. According to Article 39, subclause E, the state shall direct its policies in such way that women are not forced to work under inhuman and hazardous condition, and the health and strength of women workers are not abused. According to Article 42, the state shall make provision for securing just and humane conditions of work for women and maternity relief. Article 42 and Article 15, subclause 3 together supplements each other. Article 44 requires the state to secure for the citizens a uniform civil code throughout the territory of India. After so many years of independence and the birth of the Constitution, this dream of the founding fathers of our Constitution, a uniform civil code, has not seen the light of day. A very large section of women of our society are the sufferers. In Sharula Mudgal versus Union of India, 1955, a Supreme Court case, the Supreme Court directed the Union government to take steps for making a uniform civil code as envisaged in Article 44 of the Constitution. Justice Kuldeep Singh and Justice R.M. Sahai held the notwithstanding the constitutional mandate under Article 44, no government since 1950 has been able to introduce a uniform civil code. Taking advantage of its absence, many Hindus have changed their religion and have converted to Islam for the purpose of escaping the consequence of bigamy. In Seema versus Ashwini Kumar, 2006, the Supreme Court held that all marriages, irrespective of their religion, be compulsorily registered. This was the first step towards a uniform civil code. Moved by the plight of women fighting for their rights under marriage, like maintenance and custody of their children, a two-judge bench of Supreme Court directed the center and the state governments to frame rules which would prevent child marriage, check bigamy and polygamy, help women to exercise their rights under marriage like maintenance and custody of children, enable widows to claim inheritance and debtor husbands from deserting. And help women to exercise their rights under marriage, like maintenance and custody of children. Enable widows to claim inheritance and debtor husbands from deserting their wives. In this regard, it may not be out of place to mention that the landmark judgment on triple talaq has laid the foundation of triple talaq bill being recently passed by the parliament. In Saira Banu versus Union of India 2016, the Supreme Court on August 17, 2017, by a 3-2 majority verdict, struck down the age-old practice of instant triple talaq, also known as talaq-e-biddat, under which a Muslim man could divorce his wife by uttering the word talaq thrice. Thereafter, the Muslim woman Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2017 was passed by Parliament. According to this bill, triple talaq in any form, spoken, in writing, or by electronic means, such as email, SMS, or WhatsApp, will be illegal and void, with punishment up to 3 years of imprisonment for the husband. According to Article 51A, Subclause E, it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to promote harmony and the spirit of common brotherhood among all the people of India, transcending religious, linguistic, and regional or sectional diversities, to renounce practices derogatory to the dignity of women. There has been representation of women in local bodies like panchayats, municipalities, cooperative societies, implementation. There shall be reservation, it says that there shall be reservation of 2 seats for women on board of directors of every cooperative society consisting of individuals as members and having members from such class or category of persons. In terms of the constitutional mandate and under the directive principles of state policy, the state has enacted various legislations to counter social discrimination and various forms of violence and atrocities against women. Some of these important laws are the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act 1956, the Dowry Prohibition Act 1961, Equal Remuneration Act 1976, the National Commission for Women Act 1990, Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005, Prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006, Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace, Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013, the Muslim Woman Bill 2017, which says protection of rights on marriage of the Muslim woman. An Indian Penal Code came into force from January 1, 1862. After independence, keeping in view the constitutional mandate and the violence and atrocities to which the common Indian women are subjected to, several sections were inserted through amendment acts into the Indian Penal Code. Some of the important amendments are Section 304B, Dowry Death, inserted by Amendment Act 43 of 1886, Section 354A, Sexual Harassment and Punishment for Sexual Harassment, inserted by Amendment Act 13 of 2013, Section 354B, Assault or Uses of Criminal Force to Women with Intent to Disrobe, This was amended in 2013, Section 354C, voyeurism, inserted by Amendment Act 13 of 2013, Section 354D, stalking, inserted by Amendment Act 13 of 2013, Section 498A, husband or relative of husband of woman, subjecting her to cruelty, inserted by Criminal Law, Second Amendment Act 1983, Act of 1983. In terms of National Commission for Women Act 1990, Government of India in 1992 created the statutory body of National Commission for Women for monitoring all matters on national level relating to the rights guaranteed to women by the Constitution of India. In spite of such endeavors by the legislature and the executive at the state and national level of representation of women in parliament, the House of People, Lok Sabha, has not been much. In 2019, in the 17th election to the Lok Sabha, the number of elected women members is 78, which is nearly 14% of the total number of members. However, this is the highest number of women representation in Lok Sabha since independence. Patriarchal values and age-old traditional practices of keeping women in the backyard have time and again been thwarted and baffled by more conscious and progressive sections of the society who, along with women, have constantly been fighting to uphold the constitutional morals mandated by Articles 14, 15, 16, 21, 22, and 26. An exclusive against gender bias, the Apex Court once commented, historically, women have been treated unequally. When it comes to religion, patriarchal culture has never accepted women as their equal partners in their spiritual journey through life. The recent landmark judgments on two public interest litigations, one by Bombay High Court in 2016 on Haji Ali Dorga, a shrine in central Mumbai, where women were not allowed to enter the sanctum sanctorum, and the other by the Supreme Court in 2018 on the Sabarimala Temple, the largest Hindu pilgrimage center in Kerala, where entry of women aged between 10 to 50 years were barred, show how the verdicts in the said two PILs have broken all barriers of liberty and equality of women of all ages guaranteed under Articles 25 and 26 of the Constitution of India. Gender inequality impacts not only women, it has a ripple effect on the rest of the community. It prevents humanity as a whole to march forward towards a progressive and enlightened society. Citizens from all communities have the right to enjoy all the constitutional guarantees, and if some sections of society were held back, it is likely to hold back the community at large, resulting in unbalanced and unstable development with pockets of social backwardness. In order to achieve the goals of secularism, equality, and fraternity, and to carry forward the entire citizenry towards our constitutional goals, we must guarantee equal rights to women, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, and other socioeconomic conditions. It is then and only then that we can preserve our unity in a plural, democratic polity. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
So thank you, Janabe. Janiye, SM sir ke diye. Agostri Dibbo odher ka. number?
Well, Shomita, I finished.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, you know, for such a nice presentation. Actually, this is a very informative and illuminating presentation. On constitutional part for women. I hope your speech will help our participants to enrich their knowledge and also for research scholars who are working on this aspect. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much once again. I guess there are no questions actually from participants. So I would like to request Mr. Shubhrendu Maiti to giving a vote of thanks. So welcome you, sir. Screen is yours, sir.
Devardhu. Thank you. Shomita.
Welcome, sir.
Now, vote of thanks. We have exhausted a lot of time and energy. For two days international webinar. Entitled Health Issues and Status of Women. During the two days webinar, we had six speakers. On 28 September, there were four speakers. And on 29th, two speakers were in the webinar. On the first day, we had focused on health issues. Dr. Arun Bandyopadhyay delivered his speech on polycystic ovarian syndrome and emergent women health issue. And next speakers like Tarjana Palvika, Biljana Sardig Galik, as well as Mirjana Bhatki, presented lectures on understanding mechanisms of breast cancer development, from anthropometric measures to metabolic regulation and redox activity. Today, that is on 29th day of September 2020, we decided to focus on the theme Social Status of Women. Dr. Sutapa Chowdhury delivered her speech on women's rights and the Indian Constitution. Second speaker, that is Mr. Saurabh Ghosh, first speaker was Mr. Saurabh Ghosh, talked on the theme, the birth of a legend, Rani Durgavati, and the problem of studying gender in medieval India. And then Dr. Sutapa Chowdhury delivered her speech on women's rights and the Indian Constitution. All are quite fruitful and value-oriented attempts where the learned participants and scholars from different parts of the country enriched their knowledge and idea to understand the present scenario of our women's health and social status in the third world developing countries. For their act and cooperation for the departments of anthropology of both the institutions. Without their kind support and assistance, it was not possible for us to organize the webinar jointly. Besides, my special gratitude are also due to them for their cancellations on respective dates. Then it is my deep thanks to Professor Rajshri Mukherjee, coordinator, Sanpur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalay, and Professor Subroto Rai Choudhury, coordinator, who and assistant, fulfill our teams in a systemic manner jointly. Special thanks are also due to them for addressing welcome notes, their respective scheduled dates. My sincere thanks to Chief Guest Dr. Diptendu Chatterjee, Deputy Registrar, University of Calcutta, and faculty member, Department of Anthropology, University of Calcutta, who delivered his beautiful talk on 28th September during the beginning of first session. My special gratitude also due to another chief guest, Dr. Upala Borua, head and associate professor, Department of Anthropology, Cotton University, Assam, who shared her thought and idea related to our theme today, that is on 29 September 2020. We had four speakers on 28 September related to our theme on health issues of women. My heartiest thanks and gratitude to Dr. Arup Ratan Bandyopadhyay, Professor, Department of Anthropology, University of Calcutta, for his wonderful deliberation related to our issues. My special thanks are also due to Tarjana Palhika, full professor, Faculty of Science, University of Novi Sad, Serbia. Biljana Sardik Galik, full professor, Medical Faculty, University of Novi Sad, Serbia. And Mirjana Uriki, assistant at the Medical Faculty, University of Novi Sad, Serbia, who presented paper collectively very meaningfully and authentically to our participants. Today, on the theme Status of Women, two speakers gave their valuable speech on the different aspects related to the women. For such purpose, my sincere thanks to Dr. Sutapa Choudhury, Associate Professor, Department of Anthropology, University of Calcutta, for delivering speech despite of our busy schedules. My special thanks are also due to Mr. Saurabh Ghosh, doctorate candidate, Department of History, University of California, Berkeley, for his wonderful talk on the issues based the topic related to our main theme. My sincere thanks to two conveners of the international webinar, Hidayat Hossain, Assistant Professor, Department of Anthropology, Ramsodai College, Amta, and Ms. Soumita Chatterjee, Head, Department of Anthropology, Sampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, for their innumerable hard works for successfully launching the today's webinar. Then I must give my sincere thanks to the members of the organizing committee for their tremendous help and support to achieve our ultimate goal successfully. My thanks are also due to technical staff of the webinar for the fulfillment of our technical knowledge and difficulties. My heartiest thanks and gratitude to the distinguished other listeners who have shown their team, which even us must get this international webinar and also encourage us for our future academic planning and activities in a strategic manner. Without that key cooperation, it was not true for us to keep our friends. And then everybody would.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for being with us. A little announcement for the participants, actually. First of all, for the participants, the feedback link will be shared through emails. The feedback link only those participants will get the feedback links who have already registered. Okay. And second, this link will be shared through email. Within 24 hours, all participants will get this email. And second, I want to say sorry for this inconvenience and the poor network connectivity. So hope as you all are being with us in future, we will get your cooperation and patience. Thank you. Good night. Stay safe.